thank you that we can be here together today, and we just celebrate you and celebrate the fact that there are other believers coming together across the globe, Lord, that are going to love you and honor you and grow in you, just like we are today, by being in the presence of you and your word. We love you, Jesus, and we thank you that we can be here together today. And we can... So let us know. Let us press on to know the Lord. His going forth is as certain as the dawn, and he will come to us like the rain, like the spring rain watering the earth. Hosea 6:3.
One of my favorite songs. We've done it here before at the chapel. And it really hits to home because we need God every hour. It doesn't matter in good times or bad times. We need him at all times. And I'm just going to ask everyone here, all of our friends, brothers and sisters overseas, to listen to these words. And if you just want to pray, listen, and just rejoice to the God that we love.
One thing real quick I would like to add. Yesterday when I came to practice, Josiah said to me, I'd like to tweak the lyrics just a little bit. And the song goes, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. And he goes, I want to put we in there. And as I was singing this yesterday and practicing, it was like the dynamic of the entire song changed with one word. And I was like, what is this? What is so special about this? And then it just hit me. We're not meant to live this life alone. And as you pray or listen or sing with us, remember that, like he said, we do need God, and we're not alone.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, is Christ in me. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Thank you.
way.
And I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Such an honor and privilege to have Noah by our side. We need more individuals like him, Gianna, growing up in our world today. They're definitely going to be a spark for God and moving on. And I firmly believe that great things are coming in our future. We might be in tough times right now, but I think we're going to be, God's coming. It's going to be an amazing day. Praise God. Thank you, Noah. Well, Romans 5:8, we're going to go, but God demonstrates his own love toward us. In that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. How awesome is our God? He is absolutely awesome.
Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship Him.
We all worship today. We worship in church, but our lives should be in honor and glory and worship, an act of worship in our hearts every single day.
Remember, it's always well with your soul.
It is well.
because of your deep sacrifice and sending your only son to come and save us, we can say it is well with our souls. We know where we're going when our life on earth is through. We thank you so much and praise you for that, Lord. And we ask you, Lord, to help us make our lives an example to others so that they can see it can be well with their souls too. In Jesus' name, amen.
Looking at the book of Haggai for the next 4 weeks starting today, and that is a good question. Will you follow? But before we get to the message this morning, I'd like to bring my wife up here, and Daisy is going to give you a summary of what took place in India. Are you glad to be back? Are you glad to be back?
Yes, I am.
Are you glad to be here with me?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Good morning. And good to be home. First of all, I wanted to thank the Lord for his provision and protection he has given me to go to India and come back. And secondly, I want to thank you all for your prayers and the love and support you have given me. I could feel the prayers on my way all through out the time I spent in India, and thank you so much. And thirdly, I wanted to thank my husband who survived in my absence and for all he has done for me. And you know, I have little clutch when I went from here. I missed my flight from Dubai to India, but I survived. I could feel your prayers, and means God has put people in front of me to where to go, what to do. You know, I'm alone, and I never travel alone. That's the thing. Even though I travel with many, many times with my husband, but that's the first time I travel alone, and I lost one file and all the information I had, and that gave me a little upset. But God put people in front of me wherever I went, and I had Koshin, and I asked, I have to test again the COVID negative test in Dubai, and I have to take the train to go to another terminal and come back. Oh, it was, and I don't know, I was that much talented, but I use all my talent in Dubai because I talk to people who I don't know, and everybody's, you know, like in Dubai, is all the people speak their language, and it's hard to even understand. And wherever I went to pay or something, they asked me dirhams. And I said, I don't have dirhams. And okay, I had, luckily I have card, and I used, and I have to take visa for one day because I stayed out of country there. I have to go out of airport. And I definitely felt your prayers. Thank you so much. And 3 weeks there was wonderful, and weather-wise, super duper. And very hot, and it's my weather. I can take it, so I took it as much as I can for 3 weeks, and I bought little here, I guess. I wish I can bring more, but you know, but I can take snow too, no problem. Thank God for everything. And 3 weeks, I met so many people, and individually I talked with them, I prayed with them, I encouraged them, and I spoke God's word with them, and it was much blessing for me as personally. And of course, they shared with me, what a blessing it was. And I spoke two ladies meeting there, and all the ladies were so happy, and I shared about our ladies group here. They were so excited to know all of you, and they sent their greetings to you all. And I spoke twice in the church and shared my testimony. That reminded me again and who I was and where I come from. And it is always good to know, you know, what is your origin and who you are in the Lord. And all those things reminded me all the way my 30 years in the orphanage and here, and how good God is. And one thing I keep coming to me while I was there, and it brought me tears at times. I prayed for so many things when I was little, when I was 11, 12, 15, 16 years old, and I could see the answers now. So I will encourage you all, don't ever stop praying. Don't ever stop. Maybe not now, maybe not today, God is going to answer you, but definitely He is going to answer your prayers. Okay, so that's one thing I felt this time when I was in India. I mean, I went wherever I went. I prayed for so many years back, and I could see the result, and I was so happy to see that my prayers were answered. And I thank God for that. And one thing I challenged when we had second Saturday fasting prayer for after long, so many years, I attended the fasting prayer, and it was so blessed, so it was much blessing for me, because Papa asked me to speak to the pastors and all the people in the congregation. So I shared my testimony with that. I challenged the pastors and all the people there. And I spoke something I heard from here. And Alan Reeser in 2020 sent me a clip of something, somebody speaking of something. So I shared that. That came to my mind. So I shared the same thing I wanted to ask you today. So the clip was like, what is in your hand? What is in your hand today? And football in David Beckham, you know, is a famous football player, hand worth like $35 million. You know, like that, you can take all the things, small and big things, in people's hand worth a lot. And like a small paintbrush in Da Vinci hand was $850 million right now. I mean, what is in your hand? Two fish and five breads in a small boy's hand fed 5,000. A few nails in Jesus' hands brought the salvation for the whole world. I mean, He's asking you today. If He's asking you today, what is in your hand? I don't know what God has given in your hand. Maybe if you are saying, I don't have anything. Remember, Peter said in Book of Acts, he said, silver and gold I have none. But in the name of Jesus, he told the lame man, rise up and walk. You may not have anything, but in the name of Jesus, it's alone, enough. So I will leave that question to you. What is in your hand today? Use it for His kingdom. May God bless you. Thank you.
I'd like to show you a couple videos before we look at Haggai this morning. The first video is from Kenya. And you know, we are always attempting to advance the kingdom of God. Sometimes what we have to do is to help people just get through the day. And what you're going to see is Pastor Nicholas right now giving some much needed food. These are actually beans, a lot of nutrients in the beans. And I just want you to see this, because this is part of what we do, what you are able to do with your giving, what's in your hand.
God bless you so much.
Yeah. So the joy that is present when they're simply getting a container full of beans, that will help feed their family for several days. And we can't even really truly relate to that. But it's happening, and our people there on the ground in many countries, not just Kenya, are seeing to people's everyday needs. And we need to continue to understand what God can do with even just a little from us. Little as much when God is in it. This next video is something that Ann put together from a 13-minute video. It's down to a minute. And this is a forum, a youth forum, where the Lugos are ministering right now in Argentina. And I just want you to hear, they're singing in Spanish, but let's just watch and get a feel for their worship and for their interaction with the Argentine people.
Y lo que hizo Juan es saludar, presentarse. Hay uno que está durmiendo.
Did you notice the most of the family was up there just like they were here? They're all ministering, and we are looking forward to hearing more from them. If it's God's plan, Daisy and I and Susan will be traveling to Argentina, where we'll have opportunity to be ministering. David will be translating for us. We're looking at toward the end of March, and we're just waiting to see if Daisy gets her visa, so you can be praying about that. But remember to continue to pray for our family all over the world. You get the mission updates. You see the list of people on page 6, which is in every update, and we want you to just continually pray over them and pray for them. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to be part of so many ministries around the world. Lord, we have direct involvement with so many people, and they have involvement with us. Lord, we thank you that it is a two-way connection. And we're thanking you that you are the one that binds us together. Lord, you are so awesome. Lord, you've given us the privilege of knowing so many people and watching you do a great work in and through them. Lord, we pray that you would help us as we go through this day. Lord, I pray that you would remind us that your word is sharper than any two-edged sword. It is powerful. It can give us great comfort. It can also bring great conviction. It can bring us challenge, and it can bring us peace. Lord, I pray that we would listen carefully to what the Spirit of God is saying to each of us today and to us as a church. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Well, because it is the first of four messages, we need to give you a little background about the book of Haggai. Haggai was a prophet who had returned from exile in Babylon, and his important work is actually documented not just here in Haggai, but in Ezra. And in Ezra chapter 6, verse 14, we read this, "So the elders of the Jews continued to build and prosper under the preaching of Haggai the prophet and Zechariah. They finished building the temple according to the command of God of Israel and the decrees of the kings of Persia." Well, unlike some of the other prophets, Haggai included specific dates for his prophetic messages. And we're not going to go into a lot of detail, but those dates help us clearly. The first message he gave was on August 29th, our calendar, 520 BC, and that's found starting in Haggai chapter 1, which we're going to look at today. The second message was given on October 17th, 520 BC, and that starts at chapter 2, verse 1. The third message was presented on December 18th, 520 BC, which begins chapter 2, verse 10. And the fourth message was also given on the same day, December 18th, 520 BC, and that starts at chapter 2, verse 20. It's only two chapters long, but Haggai is a most meaningful book in Scripture. His prophecy takes place during the return from exile as the people were free to be rebuild. If you know your Bible history, in 587 BC, Israel was taken into exile by the Babylonians. But God promised them at that time that a remnant would return. So now we fast forward to the time of Haggai, and we see that much has changed. The Babylon Empire is now gone. It is in ruins, and the Persians are now in control. And under Persian rule, the Israelites are encouraged to return and build what was lost. Joshua and Zerubbabel led a group of exiles back to the land to lead in the building program. And again, we see the details of this in the book of Ezra and even when we go to the book of Nehemiah. The Jews who immigrated from Babylon to the original homeland of Judah faced intense opposition. And that came from external sources, but also from internal sources. And in the book of Ezra, we have recorded for us the external resistance. And it was a strong resistance. The enemies of Judah first attempted to infiltrate the ranks of the builders, and when that ultimately failed, they resorted to scare tactics. Haggai, on the other hand, focused on the internal opposition they faced, namely from their own sin. The Jews had thoughtlessly placed their interests before the Lord's interest. They were looking after their own safety and security without giving consideration to the claims and to the status of the Lord's house. So Haggai's encouragement to rebuild the temple in the face of the Jews' neglect brings to mind for us Paul's exhortation to Christians to build our lives on the foundation of Jesus Christ and acknowledge that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit. And we see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 10 through 17. Here is an important question to ask. Am I building a life that reflects my status as a temple of the Holy Spirit, thus leaving a legacy for Christ that will stand the test of time? We can find encouragement for our building project with these four passionate sermons that the prophet Haggai gives. And so this morning we're going to be looking at that first message, and it is a message of conviction. Look with me at Haggai chapter 1, and let's start reading at verse 1. In the second year of King Darius, in the sixth month, on the first day of the month, the word of the Lord came by Haggai the prophet to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, saying, "Thus speaks the Lord of hosts, saying, this people says, the time has not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built." Then the word of the Lord came to Haggai the prophet, saying, "Is it time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses and this temple to lie in ruins? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and bring in little. You eat, but you don't have enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put it into a bag with holes. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the mountains and bring wood and build the temple that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified, says the Lord. And we'll stop right there for now. I want to break this message down in three parts. First of all, excuses must end. Going back to verse 2, thus speaks the Lord of hosts, saying, this people says, the time has not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. And the word of the Lord came by Haggai the prophet, saying, is it time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses and this temple to lie in ruins? Well, Nehemiah and Ezra give us some really good context here. As soon as the remnant came up out of captivity, they did what was necessary. They set up an altar for sacrifice. And within a year, they laid the foundation for the temple. So in that first year, all is well. They're doing what is expected of them. They are fulfilling their mission to that point. They seemed ready to continue moving forward quickly and efficiently. But then the external opposition came. And it came in different ways. And eventually, they stopped building. Now, ultimately, the external opposition, for the most part, ended. But rather than commence with the building of the temple, they became satisfied with the altar of sacrifice. They said, look, you know, we have this. It was good enough for our father Abraham. That's what he had, just the lone sacrifice, the lone altar for sacrifice. So that's good enough for us. They were content with that. And their mission to rebuild the temple stopped. And then the excuses came. Here are some of their excuses. Our time has not come for the building of this. We have not yet recovered from our captivity. We are still dealing with the emotional aftermath of our captivity. We're still hurting. We're still stinging. It's really too great of a building project for us to undertake now. We have our own homes to look after. We have our own families to consider. We need to work harder because there's a drought right now upon us. We will get to it, but other things need to be taken care of first. Excuses. Haggai comes on the scene and basically declares, excuses must end now. What kind of excuses do we give for not obeying God? What kind of excuses do we give for not moving forward, for not rising up and doing the work, for not fellowshipping with other believers? What kind of excuses do we give for not forgiving, for not being the husband God has instructed us to be, for not praying more, for not supporting his work with our offerings? What kind of excuses are we giving for not taking that next step of faith that God has placed before us? It's important for me to recognize there is no valid excuse for not fulfilling my responsibility to obey and trust God in building up my spiritual life and advancing his kingdom. There's no valid excuse for me to give. We all know Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. Most of you have it memorized. We love that verse. those two verses. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. Let's stop right there, because that trips us up so often. Lean not on your own understanding. Do you know what leaning on your own understanding does? It lets you develop excuses that ultimately prevent you from doing what the Lord has stirred you to do. When we lean on our own understanding, we love to find other people who feel the same way about something as we do. And it makes us feel more comfortable. And then we like to find scripture and take it out of context to even validate our understanding. But sooner or later, when we lean on our own understanding, it assists us in making excuses, just like the people in Haggai's time did. Excuses must end now. Secondly, honest evaluation must begin. Excuses end. Honest evaluation must begin. Look at verse 5. Now therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much, you bring in little. You eat, but you do not have enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put it in a bag with holes. You got the picture there. There's no satisfaction. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the mountains and bring wood and build the temple that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified, says the Lord. You looked for much, but indeed it came to little. And when you brought it home, I blew it away. Why, says the Lord of hosts? Because my house that is in ruins. While every one of you runs to his own house. Let's stop right there. And let's look at verse 8 again. Go up to the mountains and bring wood and build the temple that I may take pleasure in it and be glorified, says the Lord. This is so important. And we really have to get this. When they first came back to the land, they had the funding and they had the materials necessary to construct the temple. They had it. But now, God is instructing them to go up to the mountains and bring wood necessary to build the temple. So we have to ask, what happened to all of the materials that they brought with them to build God's house? They had used those materials provided for the building of the temple to build their own homes. God's blessing was used to promote a self-centered agenda. Now get that picture. I think in the King James it says sealed houses. Here in the New King James, it says paneled homes. And when you look at the original language, it's referring to a luxurious home. They took what God had blessed them with to build his house, and they used it to build their own homes. Could it be that we are guilty of doing the same thing? God has provided us so much. As believers, we have great potential to bring glory to the Lord as we build our lives and advance his kingdom. But could it be that we have taken his blessing and we have focused on our own agenda? Take a hard look at where you are right now. Consider your ways. This is what Haggai was bringing to these people. And the conviction came. You know, by all appearances, these people were doing okay. They had beautiful homes. They had jobs, they had income. We've read that. But yet they were lacking. They weren't ever able to be satisfied. They weren't complete. Because his house was still in ruins, the Lord made sure that his people would not have satisfaction. Again, in verse 6, you have sown much and you bring in little. You eat, but you do not have enough. You drink, but you are not filled with drink. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages to put it in a bag with holes. They were just existing. In reality, their self-agenda came to nothing. They had taken all of God's blessing, and they had built their homes, and they were secure in their homes, and they were comfortable in their homes, and yet, ultimately, they had nothing. So God, through Haggai, declares again, consider your ways, which means you need to honestly evaluate where you are right now. So here's some questions that we need to ask today. Am I truly following the Lord? Am I obedient to God's word? Wait a minute. All of God's word? Am I a builder in God's kingdom? Do I realize I am the temple of the Holy Spirit? Consider your ways. God knows us, and he wants us to know and understand who we really are. What we are doing, especially when we are in need of repentance. You know, actually, it's quite easy to give people around us the appearance that everything is okay. We can create this image that says we are spiritual and that we are compliant to God's word. We can dress ourselves up quite well. We can say and do the right things that create that image. But let me ask you this question. What is in your closet? What about your back room? I told Holly yesterday that her mom has told me this nugget of truth many times. This is what Paula has said so often. The order and cleanliness of a person's closet or back room reveals more about a person's character than the rooms they invite you in to see. Got that? You see, God sees it all. God knows who we really are and what we are really doing with the blessing he has given us. We can think that we have created that image and people generally think we're okay. Maybe that's true, but God knows where we are. He knows where I am. He knows who I am. He knows who you are. What's in your closet? What's in your back room? Is it in order? Is it clean? Or is it time to open up the doors and say, Lord, you know what's there, and I'm ashamed, and I am going to honestly evaluate my life, and when I do that, I will be led to repentance. And repentance, when accomplished in front of a holy God who loves me, can bring great consequences. Thirdly, fulfill your mission. Serve the Lord. Remember, their whole reason for going back to Judah was to rebuild the temple. They did a great job with the walls. We know that from the book of Nehemiah, but then with all of the opposition, they let the building of the temple go. They needed to complete the mission. They needed to start serving the Lord instead of themselves. Look at verse 12. Then Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, with all the remnant of the people, obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the words of Haggai the prophet, as the Lord their God had sent him, and the people feared the presence of the Lord. We'll stop right there. You know, when reading through the Old Testament, we are often amazed at the rebellion of God's people. They hear the word of God, but they resist the word of God. But not this time. Haggai preached, the people listened. They were convicted. They finally came to their senses. Now, not tomorrow, not next year, now is the time to build. Their excuses ended. Honest evaluation took place, which led them to repentance. Repentance produced obedience and the fear of God. After a delay of almost 20 years, they worked on the house of the Lord, fulfilling their mission. They served the Lord. They then went up and did something that they would not had to have done if they would have just fulfilled their mission at the beginning. Now they had to go up to the mountains, which was quite a task. They had to cut down the trees. They had to hewn the wood. They had to bring it down. But they did it. And then they cleared away all of the brush and the overgrowth that the years of neglect had brought. Their hearts were stirred, their hearts were freed, and the joy of the Lord replaced that unsatisfied, empty experience that they were going through. They did the work, and God was glorified. What about us? When God brings conviction to our hearts, do we respond like these people did? Perhaps the Holy Spirit brought conviction to your heart recently through the words of a song or through a passage of scripture or a message that you were listening to or reading. Were you only emotionally moved? Or have you come to that point where you have declared excuses must end? Honest evaluation must begin. Lord, I repent. Repent of my sin, and with your help, I will fulfill my mission and will serve you. The time is now. Obey the word of the Lord. Fear God. Build your life on the firm foundation of Jesus Christ. Advance his kingdom. Fulfill your mission. Three parts to this message. And I hope you take that with you today. Excuses must end. Honest evaluation must begin. And with repentance, fulfill your mission. Serve the Lord. Father, I pray that you would help us to understand this word today as it applies to us. Lord, we are going into that part of our service where we are once again going to remember what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary. Father, thank you for sending your only Son. Jesus, thank you for becoming that sacrifice for our sin. Holy Spirit, thank you for allowing us to be convinced that we needed a Savior. And we thank you that you brought us to that place where we could receive that free gift of eternal life as we confessed and repented of our sins and asked Jesus to cleanse us. Triune God, we just acknowledge you today. We are so grateful for you. It's clear from Scripture that we are to often, when we come together in fellowship, to remember this very fact that Jesus Christ gave his life for us. It's not something that we do because we We have to. And it's simply another one of our duties. It's something we do because we know it's how the Lord gives us opportunity to remember what he did for us on the cross of Calvary. And if there's anything in our life that's unpleasing to him right now, we're able to once again repent of that. Let go of excuses. Evaluate ourselves honestly. Repent of sin. And rise up and fulfill our mission. Remembering Jesus and what he did on the cross of Calvary gives us that opportunity. He loves us so much. He never wants us to forget that we've been bought with a price. Our flesh is so weak, and the world is so loud, and our enemy is so crafty. And this is an opportunity for us to absolutely refocus and to truly remember who we are in Jesus Christ. We remember his sacrifice, what he did for us on the cross of Calvary. We remember that he was in that tomb for 3 days, 3 nights, and then he rose from the dead. And he is alive today, the resurrection and the life. And in the person of the Holy Spirit, he resides inside of us. And we are sealed unto the day of redemption. And we know for sure that he is coming back again. And if we are in that generation where he comes, we will be changed in an instant as we are called up to meet him in the air. And if we are not in that generation and we go through the process of death, we are able to say, death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? This is why we remember Jesus and what he did for us so many years ago on the cross of Calvary. If you are a believer in Christ, you are following him. This is the table that the Lord has set up for you. If you have never trusted Christ as your Savior, I would say to you right now, once again, God loves you. And his desire is that no one would perish, but that everyone would have everlasting life. And you can right now, wherever you are, confess, repent of your sin, and trust Jesus as your Savior. And I would invite you to do that. And after you have come to Christ, after you have just simply prayed, Lord, save me. I believe that you died for me. I believe you rose from the dead. I am repenting of my sin. After you have done that and invited Jesus Christ to cleanse you from your sin, I would encourage you to go to a fellow believer, go to someone, a pastor, someone that you know is following Christ, and let them know what you've done. Believer in Christ, maybe you're frustrated. We all get that way. Maybe you are constantly confessing and repenting of the same thing over and over again. We all understand that experience. Don't give up. This is the time that we can reflect on how much Jesus loves us and how he is long-suffering. And he is so gentle and kind and willing to forgive. And let's take that forgiveness today. And let's rise up and let excuses go. Examine our lives honestly. And get ready to be renewed and revived and refreshed so that we can fulfill our mission. Father, help us as we go through this time. Jesus, again, thank you. We want to remember you. You are so precious. You have done so much for us. Holy Spirit, just take us, convict us, challenge us, comfort us, give us that peace that passes understanding. We pray that this time, O Lord, will be a time of great benefit to us as we prepare for another day, another week with you. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. This is a time for you to, again, let go of any excuse that you have. Let go of any self-centered agenda. This is the opportunity for you to evaluate honestly where you are and who you are in Christ. This is the time for us to remember. Think of what Jesus did for each of us. What he did for me, what he did for you. Isn't that amazing? All of us were sinners, condemned with no hope for any kind of eternal life. And Jesus Christ put himself on that cross. No one took his life from him. He freely gave it, the scripture says. This is our time to remember him and to remember that his blood is like that fountain that brings cleansing. I can say to you as your brother, I love you. And I want you to hear the Spirit of God just speaking so tenderly and quietly to each of you at this time. Listen, God loves you. Hear the word. God loves you. No matter what you've done, God loves you. And you can listen to the message of Haggai and recognize God is ready and able to forgive and to bring satisfaction and peace that cannot be compared to anything that we could find in this world. So let's remember our friend, our Savior, our God. Let's remember Jesus today. Let's stand together.
There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged
took the bread and he broke it. He gave thanks. He said, "This is my body which will be given for you. As often as you eat it, do it in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he took the cup. He said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink it, do it in remembrance of me." I'm going to ask my brother Noah if he could come at this time. I'm going to ask him if he can close us in a word of prayer today.
Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you in Jesus' name. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for the honor it is to be in your presence and to worship you. Thank you for the adoption of us as your children. Thank you for the price that you paid, Lord Jesus. And thank you we can have hope. A hope that is found in no one else but you. Lord, as we go about our week, be with us. Help us to draw near to you. Help us to remember that we truly need you. Lord, let us to bless you and glorify you with our lives. Help us to put aside excuses. Help us to honestly evaluate. And Lord, help us to fulfill our mission. Thank you. Thank you for all that you have done for us and all that you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.